have such a large audience here today of students, guests, friends of Hofstra with us. Allow me to welcome you to our event. My name is Mina Bose. I am the Executive Dean for Public Policy and Public Service Programs in the Peter S. Calico School of Government, Public Policy, and International Affairs, as well as the director of our Calico Center for the Study of the American Presidency. And I am delighted to welcome you to our first Calico event of the spring semester, a discussion with Professor William Howell of his recent book, Presidents, Populism, and the Crisis of Democracy. I have a few of his other books here as well. I'm going to turn it over to a colleague in a moment, but actually, Will, I have Power Without Persuasion. I think I took off the dust jacket, so I have to turn it this way. And I have your copy of Relic, I just realized, at home. So that's why it's not in my stack right here. But let me just say as a welcome, although I wish we were all convening in person, we have had the distinct pleasure of welcoming Professor Howell to Hofstra recently. He delivered the Sutherland Lecture in the fall of 2018, discussing his 2016 book with Terry Moe, titled Relic, regarding the Constitution and the need for a stronger presidency, among other potential reforms. And that argument is further developed in his more recent book. So we are delighted, and which he told us about in 2018. So we are delighted to continue the conversation. At this time, I'm gonna turn the floor over to my colleague, Dr. Philip Dalton, Associate Professor of Rhetoric at Hofstra and Director of our Center for Civic Engagement. Professor Dalton organized this event and delighted that he is joining us today along with his class. Dr. Richard Himmelfarb is here with his Contemporary Issues in American Politics class. I see some of the students here, and delighted to see many of our colleagues in the audience as well. So I won't list everyone by name, but rather I'll turn it over to Professor Dalton. Phil, please go ahead.
Thank you, Mina. Good morning to everyone. I'd like to thank you all for being here with us for this timely discussion focused on the book co-authored by William Howell and Terry Moe titled Presidents, Populism, and the Crisis of Democracy. My name is Phil Dalton. I'm a professor of rhetoric and public advocacy here. And my own work is primarily focused on political communication. And so during the Trump presidency, my mind kept returning to the norms, the genres and formulas for presidential rhetoric that I learned in grad school and that I continue to read about. Trump's public talk didn't fit much of what I'd learned, and it violated presidential conventions of nearly every kind. One familiar form of talk it reminded me of was that of populist talk, which seems under-theorized. Robert Rowland, a noted rhetorical scholar, wrote of Donald Trump's presidency that he, quote, violated every rule of presidential campaigns, noting that even his gaffes played a role in further activating his supporters. And in a piece in Communication Quarterly, Edward Apel asserts that Trump's, quote, Trump's aggressive, eccentric, and successful manner of attack may pre-signify a new and possibly enduring political and party alignment. Certainly, President Trump gives us a lot to think about. And so we are very honored to have with us today Dr. William Howell, one of the authors of Presidents, Populism, and the Crisis of Democracy. In it, he reflects on the rise of populism in American politics and its implications for presidential power, the capacity of government to solve public problems, and the need for institutional reform. Dr. Howell is the Sidney Stein Professor in American Politics at the University of Chicago. Currently, he is the chair of the Department of Political Science, director of the Center for Effective Government, and co-host of Not Another Politics podcast. And before I hand things over to Dr. Howell, I want to thank those who made today's talk possible, namely the Peter S. Calico School of Government, Public Policy, and International Affairs, the Peter S. Calico Center for the Study of the American Presidency, Hofstra Center for Civic Engagement, and Hofstra's Cultural Center, which always makes these fine events possible. And so now it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Howell.
It's a delight to be joined with you all. And thanks for inviting me, Phil. I'm hoping we can have a conversation about this book and about what's happening in American politics. The presidency, I study the American presidency. That's sort of my, presidents have been my protagonists in trying to make sense of what goes on in American politics more generally. But presidents are implicated in this moment in all kinds of ways, both as we want to argue in this book, threat to democracy, but also as indispensable to a healthy democracy. So what I'm hoping we can do is sort of unpack the arguments and make sense of this as a joint venture. If I could put out one thing, which I think is worth just to make sure we're all on the same page, is worth noting, which has to do with what we mean by populism. Because there are lots of definitions in circulation and they each point towards different phenomena. And I want to be clear about the phenomena that concerns us and what we mean when we say that Trump is a populist. It is not the kind of colloquial understanding which suggests that populists align themselves with average everyday people and stand up to organized interests and argue vehemently on behalf of policies of redistribution and the reallocation of power and the expansion of the franchise. That's a sort of popular notion of populism. It's not what we have in mind. And it's not what most scholars of populism talk about. Rather, their formulation is quite different. The sort of core critique that populists offer of a political order is one that is sweeping in nature and points towards an entire political order as being discredited. It's about saying our politics to their core are broken, they're irredeemably broken. And I alone can fix it, right? You have at once a deep, sweeping, wholesale critique of small d democratic populists conjoined with an appeal to the personal efficacy of somebody who's traditionally an outsider coming in to say, look, the DC establishment, the traditional American parties, they're all to their core rotten, but look to me for your salvation. And that move, particularly that latter move, is a profound threat, we want to argue, to democracy, because it has to do with the personalization of power and serves as primary justification for violations of the rule of law, the stoking of disaffection with our politics, a rising levels of distrust in traditional modes of political engagement. It is not a constructive force for enhancing the franchise, encouraging deeper, more meaningful engagement with our politics, or we would suggest sustained attention to institutional reform, which we'll get to, we think is what's desperately needed when we think about how do we excavate ourselves from this particular moment and the threat that it presents to our democracy. So therein lies our definition of populism. I don't want us to lose sight of it. But I welcome thoughts, questions, so we can sort of unpack this book in this moment.
Thank you, William. What we were going to do is myself, Dr. Bose, and Dr. Himmelfarb, is we have some questions that we prepared. We'll do that for about 45 minutes. And then after about that time, we'll invite questions from the audience. They can be written in the chat. And Mina, I imagine they can raise their hands and ask. Is that a possible? Yes, very good.
Yeah, right, I was just going to say, when we open it up for that, we'll open up the chat at that time for people to put in questions, or they can raise their hands and we'll call on them.
So, I'm happy to begin. Pardon me as I wrote this, so it may sound less conversational and more readerly, but you write, unless new elections lead to a significantly more effective government, there is nothing to stop new populist leaders from picking up where Trump left off. What is your assessment of Biden's governance, and will it be enough to restore faith in the system's efficacy as you see it so far?
So there are two big questions embedded in there that I want to draw our attention to both. One has to do with populism, where it comes from, and its likelihood of enduring, and two, having to do with what constitutes a meaningful response to it. So this definition I've offered of populism, what we need to grapple with and what we try to grapple with in the book is, you know, when do these arguments resonate? When do they take hold in our politics? When is it likely that somebody who comes forward and says that everything is broken is likely to, you know, gather attention and gather support? And that, look, there are lots of things that can be contributing factor, where we don't live in a monocausal world. The thing that we want to draw attention to is the failures of government to solve public problems. That government ineffectiveness is a contributing factor to not just anger and disaffection and harm felt by a public, but in turn, it opens up opportunities for a would-be populist demagogue to step forward and to say, you're right, the government has failed, and it's failed you because it doesn't care about you. It doesn't recognize you and all, and whereas I do. I, the outsider, I brandish my credentials as worthy of your support by virtue of the fact that I'm not implicated in this mess. And so what we need to then think about is, well, what do we do in order to produce a government that can meaningfully attend to public problems that the American public recognizes as the legitimate subject of government action, recognizing that what those problems are decidedly political in nature? Like, I don't want to suggest that somehow, well, of course, we all agree about what the problems are or what the solutions are. Politics runs through all of this. The question is, on the backside of that, do we have a set of institutions that can deliver? And we argue, for a host of reasons, which I'm sure we'll unpack as our conversation proceeds, the answer is no. There's lots of impediments. A thing that we call for in the book, call for a number of things. One is a sustained attention to the need for institutional reform. We need to revisit the powers given to presidents, in light of both the promise of presidential leadership, but also the very real threat that presidents present. And that needs to be a subject of urgent attention. And so when you say, how is Biden done? I would ask, well, how, with what urgency has he brought to the work of institutional reform? And to which I would say, I don't think he's neglected it. I don't think he's ignored it. I think he sees the threat, but his attention, frankly, has been elsewhere. And it's been on a pandemic. It's been on the economic fallout of a pandemic. It's been on an effort to pass massive sweeping social policies, and he's enjoyed sort of mixed success on those fronts. And the work of building and sustaining coalitions around the work of institutional reform has not been undertaken with the kind of urgency that Terry and I think it needs to be undertaken with, recognizing that there are all kinds of impediments, of course, to making headway on rebuilding institutions, reallocating power, redesigning systems of lawmaking, of policymaking, in ways that allow for the possibility that good policies might actually be adopted, that we might make headway on the kinds of challenges that we as a country face. We just haven't seen much action on those fronts. There's some talk on filibuster reform, and then, you know, which I would say, how much leadership did Biden provide on that front? So I gave him a grade on this front. I gave him a B minus or a C plus in a time when what we need is a president to step forward and provide kind of an A plus performance. There's a lot to unpack here, but that's the start.
Okay, if I could follow up with that.
Please.
The institutional reform is necessary to affect the changes in material issues for people. And so I guess my question came from a place of, he's tried to address those material issues, and on some levels he's been successful. And as I hear you speak, I think of conversations I've had with Trump supporters who, and not just Trump supporters, but people who are disaffected and really not aligned in any way. They do want institutional reform. So I guess my question was about the material things he's done. And correct me if I'm wrong, but your answer is it's done some good, but it doesn't get to the core of the problem.
I think that that's right. I think, and it's we got a chicken and egg problem, right? Which is, I mean, the two big things that we push for in the book are, one, sustained attention by the federal government to the material harm and the anxieties that are felt by millions of Americans associated with big technological changes that have played out over the last several decades, the rise of globalization, changing immigration patterns, the whole bunch of things that in the background have stirred up big challenges to government. And the question is, how well have they met them? Not so well. And that they need to attend to that. They, meaning the government, needs to attend to that. The reason why I said chicken and egg problem is that, well, it's really hard given separation of powers, given the level of polarization between the Democrats and the Republicans, given the thin majorities enjoyed by the Democratic Party to make headway and adopt big sweeping policy changes, much less big sweeping policy changes that have the effect of, that can meaningfully attend to underlying problems, right? That can effectively attend to people's material wants and harms and anxieties. And for that, we need institutional reform, right? Like for that, that's where we have, in many ways, a broken legislative process. That Congress is a mess for all kinds of reasons that impede the possibilities of policymaking. And we need to attend to that. So, but then how do you do one without the other, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mina.
Great, thanks. So Will, I had a different question prepared for you, but hearing your comments, I'm gonna modify this this slightly. Because I think your point, your central argument with Terry Moe here about the pressing need for institutional reform, right? This dates back to 2016. You've been developing this analysis right now for several years. And you made a very clear point when you visited Hofstra in 2018 of saying, these are institutional questions. They're not predicated on who's in power. Just to summarize it, you said, if we agree that these changes are needed, then it doesn't matter whether it's Trump. I mean, it matters, but whether then you have to accept the need for that, whether it's Trump, Obama, Biden, whoever it might be in 2024. But it seems to me that there's this tension between the conceptual and the practical. And I hesitate to move so quickly to the second one, but when your first book came out on this topic in 2016, in the summer of 2016, it seemed as though, well, maybe the Constitution could be updated, but can't we work within this current system? I recall reading it and having these discussions in political science gatherings. Then after the 2016 election, you had some people who said, no, we really need to reform the system, and others who said, we can't do it now. It's just too risky. And I wonder if you could comment, as you were just speaking now about saying that Biden has not been attentive to institutional reform. How can he be when he has to deal with so many policy issues? And how can any sitting president, how is it possible to achieve institutional reform while we're governing in practice? It seems to me that this takes us back to 1787. So I'm just the feasibility of this. I know that moves beyond your specific reforms, but I'm just curious as to how you think we navigate the here and now with institutional rebuilding.
It's not easy, right? I mean, it is, we make no pretense that somehow, just set to work, make these few fixes and we're good. And to look over at Biden to say, well, why aren't you just making those few fixes? There are all kinds of things that stand in his way. And there are all kinds of pressing policy challenges that require immediate attention. And there are as well, not just disagreements between the two parties, but I would argue, and we lay out in the book in some detail, that for the most part, the Republican Party isn't in the business of attending to the work of institutional reform in the service of a more effective government. That's not what populists do, and populism has taken hold in important respects of the Republican Party. Okay, so how do you move forward? Really, really hard. If you have a model for the way that this is played out successfully at some time, I think the closest we would get to is the progressive period of the late 19th, early 20th century. And this is not to say that their solutions were the right solutions, but it is to say that that was over a sustained period of time, an effort by successive administrations to say we need a more modern government that can meet modern challenges, and the Constitution in important ways stands as an represents an impediment to that work. And they this is where we got the administrative state initially being crafted. And we had all kinds of changes to who participated in the polity and how policy was made. And it played out over decades. And it came in fits and starts, but those considerations were sort of raised up in our politics, and people were engaging them in a serious-minded way. And I'd say that's what we need right now, is we need to have hard, serious-minded conversations about how we rethink the presidency for modern times. Because I don't think it's just a story of just empowering the president. It's also a story about curbing powers that presidents currently have, with an eye towards the, on the one hand, the distinct kinds of leadership that presidents, by virtue of where they sit, stand to offer our politics, but also representing the very real threat that the presidency can present when a demagogue occupies the office. Your original point, I think, is an important one that we mustn't ever lose sight of, which is that when we think about institutional reform, we can't reason from our, you know, our favorite politician or from our least favorite politician and say, well, I, you know, we have to think about what kind of a system do we want? What kinds of representation do we want to facilitate and support? And we have to live with the consequences, recognizing that elections have consequences and we won't always have our favorite person in office. If your response to the election of 2016 is, oh my God, Donald Trump assumed power, and I look with him at him with a fair measure of fear, loathing, and disgust, and so that the right institutional response therefore is to shut everything down and make it impossible for him to actually get anything done, I'd suggest two things. First, there's a strain of that sentiment which is anti-democratic, which is, again, we have to live with the consequences of elections. We don't always get the person who we want, number one. And number two, it's to ignore the central role the president faces in building a more effective government. And if the concern that you have about Trump is that he's a populist, that's a concern that I have. I have concern about populism and its threat to democracy, that we need to think about then where populism takes hold and how it has taken hold of our politics. And the appropriate response there is to say that we need as a government that can solve problems, that can actually do things on behalf of people, communities that have been hurt by globalization, that can actually reconstitute an immigration system that, whether you're from the left or the right of the political spectrum, all people throughout recognize is irredeemably broken, and yet we can't seem to find a way to actually attend to the problems. And that's not just a matter of us being intransigent or disagreeing with one another and not being able to find common ground. That also has to do with the institutions that define how we come together and speak across difference and lay the groundwork for actual action and actual attention to trying to the underlying problems. So how do we do it? I mean, I think what we have to be able to sort of walk and chew gum and juggle on a high wire act, right? We've got to be able to, it's just not easy. I mean, we don't, and where we end the book is to say we may not succeed. We may not be able to pull this off. Like there are no guarantees in this. For my taste, I would like to see the president and his advisors speaking more about the need for institutional reform and carving out a more robust space in our politics where those considerations are attended to, recognizing that he doesn't have the political support in Congress to actually do it all today. That's clearly not. But that if we're going to make progress, that's going to play out over years. and that the groundwork needs to be laid. And part of what laying that groundwork means is having these discussions, putting ideas forward, building coalitions in support of it, even though we can't, they clearly don't have the sort of majorities that we would require to adopt those policies now. So those are some of the strands, I think.
Thank you.
I think Richard, Dr. Himmelfarb had a question that yes. kind of actually picks up from where we were. So I'll give my question to him. Go ahead.
I went through the book, and there's a real tone in the book that Democrats good, Republicans bad, liberals good, conservatives bad, technocrats good, libertarians bad, and I take issue, I guess, with this idea that this is all sort of a phenomenon of Republicans and conservatives, the fact that institutions are in trouble. I think about this issue of legitimacy of elections. And, when Trump won the election in 2016, there were any number of Democrats who basically said that he was not the legitimate winner of the election. Questions about legitimacy of Republican victories goes all the way back to, 2000 and then 2004, when you had, Robert F. Kennedy writing in Rolling Stone magazine about the Diebold machines and Democrats being unwilling to attend George W. Bush's first inauguration. Stacey Abrams still claiming that she is the legitimate governor of Georgia, even though she clearly lost in 2018. So I guess what I'm wondering is how I look at this and say, well, this is a plague on both your houses, and you seem to hold Republicans, very much at fault for the vast majority of the problems we have. So comment, if you will.
It's a great question. We don't want to argue, nor do we argue, that the distinction between liberals and conservatives is one in which, liberals descend from on high and conservatives are the problem. Quite the opposite. Terry Moe is a fellow at the Hoover Institution. And he and I have both written in the policy work that we've done over the course of our careers on behalf of things that are kind of hallmarks of conservative thought. Our concern is with populism, and our concern is that populism has taken hold of, it's channeled through Trump and has taken hold of the Republican Party in ways that it decidedly has not has taken hold of the Democratic Party. I think you can point to, as you have, examples where members of both parties raise questions about the legitimacy of previous elections. But I would resist the argument that there therefore is some kind of equivalence between the murmurings of some Democrats and the kind of behavior of Trump and the many, many people within the Republican Party who want to attend to him and proceed in fear of him, that his unwillingness to simply even recognize the legitimacy of Biden's presidency is a very big deal. There's no Democratic equivalent of that. And the lies that he has propagated throughout his presidency, the personalization of power that he has channeled, that he is we lay out this in some detail in the book, he is a classic populist. And populism represents a profound threat to democracy. There are versions of populism in Latin America that are rooted in the left of the political spectrum. And I would say those too are decided threats to the democracies of Latin America in ways that right-wing populism, which has taken hold in this country and in significant portions of Europe, represents a threat to these democracies. So we don't want to argue that somehow arguments about the appropriate scope of government or the purposes of government are ones that liberals have sorted out and conservatives have don't. That's not our claim. Our claim is that populism is born of ineffective government, that one party in particular has taken hold of the mantle of populism, and in doing so, has made a set of commitments that represent a decided threat to small d democracy, and that stand in the way of the kind of institutional reform that we need to build a more effective government. And I'll say that this last piece is important, that the work of populism is not to say, okay, here's the critique of government, now let's roll up our sleeves, clear our minds, and set to work on fixing it. The work of the populace is start to finish to sow disaffection and anger all the way through. It's not to take you to a place that says, okay, here's what a more effective, but smaller, a leaner administrative state ought to look like. The work of a populace is to at once politicize the administrative state and to undermine the administrative state, and then to use it in ways that allow the populace to brandish his own power to reward enemies and prosecute, reward friends and prosecute enemies. So there's lots more to say about the different pieces of that. This is not, we tried to be clear about this here. This is not our effort to lionize liberals and the claims that everything that they say is good and great, or to condemn conservatives. It's a concern about how populism has taken hold in our politics and has grabbed hold of a major American party, and that represents a distinct threat to democracy.
Thank you. Mina, did that answer your question? Is it okay?
Yes, yeah, thank you. Please, go ahead, Bill.
Can you talk about the role of the strength of parties or of their waning strength in an era of self-funded candidates, I've heard called instant IPO candidates like Trump, that the Democratic Party is now considering, or not, I can't say the party, but I've heard it talked about bringing Michelle Obama onto the ticket in the next election if Biden were to bow out. What role do you see the state of our parties playing in addressing the rise of populism?
Well, party. Terrifically important. And when we think about institutional reform, we certainly ought to set our sights not just on the presidency, which is what the subject of this book is, and how to rethink the presidency of a modern time, expanding some powers, restricting and eliminating others, but to think anew about parties in our constitutional order and what they might do to offer some. I mean, you could see the tension here. At once, to discipline debate and to curate potential candidates on the one hand, and on the other hand, to reach out and to democratize the process more generally. It's hard to imagine somebody like Trump getting the nomination. Before the reforms of the early 1970s to the two parties, which led to the expansion of primaries, and it reduced the ability of parties to play this curatorial role. I mean, he was able to activate the imaginations of a non-trivial portion of the American electorate all the way through the primary process without mainstream at that time. I think the mainstream has decidedly shifted since 2016 within the Republican Party, but the mainstream Republican support then, I'd say it's not obvious that the existing caucus and primary system by which the two parties select who their nominee is going to be is decidedly or necessarily better on small d democracy grounds when you have the levels of turnout that we observe throughout the season and the influence of organized of both money and organized interest playing such an important role through this process. But I'll say that this isn't to say that, you know, going back to the parties of the 50s and 60s, where a handful of party elites got to say who the next steward was going to be is the solution either. I'm not a scholar of parties, but it's quite clear to me that there's work that needs to be undertaken there. I'm not hopeful right now I don't see the signs of either party actually undertaking this work in a concerted way. I think that they're both paying attention to the next election and they're thinking about their chances of actually winning and how do we, you know, fend off the evil and awful of the opposite side and not thinking about in a holistic way about what role do we play in the constitutional order and how do we interact with and try to attend to the deficiencies of our separation of powers system that makes problem solving so difficult, which I think had been and has been the subject of sustained attention by party activists in the past. I don't think it is right now. I think right now they're thinking, they're scrambling about saying, how do we win? Mm-hmm. But that work needs to happen there. Do you have ideas about what their fixings to be? I mean,
I think taking money out of the system. And as you were talking, I was thinking of what I tend to characterize as an ability on the political right to exploit what Democrats will advocate for and then play that against them. And you have this moment where you have senators like Hawley coming out against senators and members of Congress trading on stock, which is a moment where, say, Democrats could see an opening there to find some people on the right to impose some reforms. Maybe there are folks on the right who would have voice issues and maybe kind of made to support legislation that would, you know, be in line with the things they've advocated for. Anyway, that getting money out of the system in some way, though, given that campaign money is considered speech within our system, that's part of that institutional reform that I think you're talking about that needs to be fixed. But that's constitutional level stuff. And I hope I'm not very hopeful for that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mina.
Well, I wanted to ask a question about social media, but I think I'm going to hold off on that and just ask, because I know we're going to open up for audience questions soon. Would you say a little more, as many of the people in the audience, but not all, I think, have read President's Populism and the Crisis of Democracy. Could you talk a little bit about the reform proposal about fast track authority for presidents and what this entails? And then with that, whether you think our current system of separated institutions, sharing powers, the checks and balances are sufficient to prevent abuses of executive power, if we're talking about expanding the president's authority in this regard.
Yeah, great. So can I give a thumbnail sketch maybe of we argue on behalf of expanding presidential power, but also of restricting it. And let me, if I could touch on both, that would be terrific, just to give people a clear sense about what the undertaking here is. When it comes to expanding power, the argument is that presidents offer a kind of leadership that runs in short supply in our national politics. And that is that presidents, by virtue of where they sit, by virtue of their concerns about legacy, by virtue of their career trajectories, tend to pay attention to the country as a whole, not perfectly, but more so than do. And that we need people who are going to pay attention to the country as a whole in our politics, if we're going to meet the kinds of modern challenges that stand before us. And when you look over at the legislative process and you see the deep dysfunction in the multiple veto points and the localism that runs rampant through Congress, and try to say, what might a reform look like to the legislative process that allows for the two first branches of government to set their sights on the country as a whole, and to pay attention to the long-term implications of policy change, we could adopt something like universal fast-track authority. It's something that we have in trade policy, wherein what happens when it comes to trade policy is that, not the president himself, but trade representatives negotiate the terms of an agreement with another country, that then are taken over to Congress and that Congress has to vote on them on an up or down basis. And the reason why they made this move, rather than letting Congress negotiate these terms, is that they were concerned, they meaning legislators recognized, that they couldn't put a lid on, couldn't be counted to put a lid on all the entreaties of organized interests asking for special dispensation in trade agreements. And so by shifting the authority over the agenda setting of power over to the president in this space, they may be able to think about liberalizing, that is not as in trade policy that serves the interests of liberals, but liberalizing trade as an opening up international trade to the larger world was in the nation's interest. And the president stood well equipped to make headway on that ground, on that front, in ways that legislators couldn't be counted on. So we argue that this could be opened up into other policy domains where the president could come forward and to say, here is a comprehensive immigration reform bill. And you, Congress, have to vote on it. You can vote it down, but you have to vote on it. If you fail to vote on it, it's going to automatically become law. And so that will introduce a kind of accountability within Congress, which would be good for our politics. It would ensure that the president, as a steward of national interests, can put forward proposals that then will be the subject of robust congressional debate. And this would enliven the legislative process, which would be good. Okay, expansion of presidential power. There's all kinds of ways in which the president represents, particularly when a demagogue assumes the presidency, represents a threat to the political order, and that such a demagogue, when using certain powers that are available to him, someday her, wouldn't be in the service of national interests or a more effective government. It would be in the service of feathering his own nest and asserting his own power, and that this is something that ought to deeply concern us. We outline a bunch of concerns in this space. Let me just say I'll say two. There are many more. One is a simple one, which is the pardon power ought to be eliminated, we think. The pardon power does nothing to enhance the efficacy of government. And when a demagogue occupies that office, it can be used and it can be used, and we've seen it used in order to attend to the interests of political allies, and not to, in any systematic way, right injustices, right wrongs within the judiciary, right? This is about rewarding, offering political favors to friends. So it's a targeted thing, but an important thing. A more expansive one has to do with the politicization of the administrative state. This is something, Mina, that you know and you've written on at length, that we have a whole lot of literature that shows that the politicization of the administrative state corrupts the ability of agencies to do their job. It creates all kinds of bad incentives. It increases turnover. That this is the stuff not of good government. This is the stuff of political control. And that we are a huge outlier relative to other industrialized countries. And so a thing that we argue here is that the president's ability to make these political appointments should be restrained, should be reduced, and reduced significantly. There are a number of other powers that we think also ought to be cut back. But the undertaking here is to think anew about what a modern presidency for modern times ought to look like, recognizing at once the indispensability of presidents in the service of a more effective government on the one hand, and on the other, the threat that presidents can represent to our democracy. And it's not about splitting the difference between these two, but attending to this two-pronged test when we undertake the work of institutional reform.
Very good. Thank you.
Can I just ask one quick question? Would you share with us your views about the filibuster and whether it should be maintained, and how that might fit into your conception of how government needs to be remade?
So I think this is a great question, and I don't have a hard and fast answer on this one. I think this is about weighing different trade-offs. I think most of the arguments on behalf of the filibuster are bad arguments. I'll say that. The first one is that the arguments that the filibuster is vital for increasing public debate and deliberation. I just don't think there's any evidence in favor of this. I have a new paper which shows as much empirically. And that the argument that says that we need a filibuster to ensure policy stability is there. I'd like to see some more empirical work done on it. My sense is that what we really get with a filibuster is a kind of lurching on the legislative side, where there's no action, no action, no action, and then suddenly all kinds of action in the form of this massive omnibus legislation, and then all kinds of unilateral action, which is marked by all kinds of instability, which would not be, which is problematic for all kinds of reasons when you think about good policymaking. The concern that I have with just sort of eliminating the filibuster is that the Senate is in important ways really anti-democratic, and we can live in a world in which if you get rid of the filibuster entirely, that a minority of the country retains a majority of the seats in the Senate, and that in a funny way, the filibuster operates as a restriction on the minority rule in this particular instance, and a guard against the possibility that this is true for the last 3 years of the Trump presidency. He was a president who didn't win with a plurality of the votes and had the majority party. When the Republicans held the majority, they represented about 43-44% of the country. And there are reasons to be concerned that in such a world that their ability to pass laws was restricted by the filibuster. And I would have the same concern if the same dynamic were playing out on the Democratic side. And so I don't think it's just a matter of getting rid of it. Last thing I'll say on this is that Ken Shepsley at Harvard and a couple of law professors have a really creative solution to this particular problem, which is worth checking out. We talk about it on an episode of Not Another Politics podcast. The thing to say is I don't think the answer is just about getting rid of the filibuster. We've got to think about other things to do, because the filibuster is embedded in this anti-democratic, in many ways, chamber, and that you can, and other pathologies will be unleashed if you just get rid of it. That's a start.
Thank you. All right, at this point, I want to transition to questions from the audience, so to speak. And so we can do that by having people raise their virtual hands. We have a hand up here, Mr. Kesselman. And by the way, if you have questions you'd like to just enter into the chat, you're invited to do that as well, and we'll thread those into the conversation. Mina, I don't control the mute. Can you unmute?
I'm sorry. You know what? I keep doing that. I just did it. So now you can unmute speakers when they're, yeah.
I'm unmuted. May I proceed?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, let me shut the phone off first. It seems that we're talking much about the president and his ability being restricted or enabling him to take advantage. What I have to concern with is the facilitating of getting things done. It seems much to me that Congress is like king of the hill between the two parties. Then nothing gets done because they're at each other's throats, and it's like personal as opposed to really putting your heart and soul into getting things done. I understand that during Reagan's administration, he and Tip O'Neill used to have a Friday morning tip, so to speak, chat with a drink or two, and to get things done, what was on each other's mind and how we can both reach the goal that we want, even though we're in opposing parties. And that's what I think we need more of, as opposed to restricting the president, not restricting the president and everything else, because I have a warm feeling. And the rest will just follow if they put their minds together and say, for the good of the people, this is what I feel we have to do, as my party feels this, and this is the way the other one feels, and work it out, and put it to a lot of these junior congressmen, get them on committees and everything else. Their first 2 years, especially in the House of Representatives, they're first getting their feet with it. Nothing gets done, and it instead of restricting powers and things like that, if they would put their minds to not restricting things, but getting things out into the open and have in their hearts and in their minds that we want to do something for the good of the people. And you have a conservative view and you have a liberal view and some place to meet in between with their hearts and minds set on doing that. That's what we need from behind the scenes. Otherwise, nothing gets done, as we've seen during the past few years. It's a fighting for the king of the hill.
Thank you, Emil. Mr. Howell, do you have any thoughts on that?
Briefly, the concern about not getting anything done is a concern that we share. I think that when we think about government dysfunction, it presents itself in lots of ways. One is the pervasive gridlock in the face of pressing problems. But as institutionalists, we actually think that a lot rides on the rules of that govern how difference is attended to, that the two parties disagree vehemently with one another. And we don't live in a world in which we can simply, over a cup of tea, sort of find the warm feeling and then chart a pathway forward. It's going to matter how we engage one another, and how we engage one another is a function of the kinds of rules and powers and norms that govern interbranch relations, which is why we want to rethink those rules. It's in the face of the pervasive gridlock and dysfunction, even when you have different kinds of people in power, that convinces Terry and I that what we need to do is say, all right, let's build this anew from the ground up, and think about how we might enliven a legislative process that right now is irredeemably broken.
Thank you. Mr. Zucker, can you unmute, please? You're still muted. Here, I will.
He should be able to now.
There you go.
Thank you very much. Thanks again. And it's great having this, being part of this. And it's Dr. Boyce. It's nice to see Dr. Boyce. I saw you last time in 1998 when you had Arthur Schlesinger at Hofstra, where he had the presidential conference, which was great. Thank you. If you take a line from, say, Joseph McCarthy to Spiro Agnew to a few others, but certainly Sarah Palin and Donald Trump, you have a line of anti-intellectualism that, you know, Mr. Hofstadter would have had to have written a sequel to his earlier book about. What relationship do you see for the anti-intellectual establishment to populists, please?
It's a strain of populism. And I mean, I thank you for raising the question, because we don't want to say that populism came on scene for the first time with Donald Trump in 2016, that populism has a longer lineage in our country. It is also, what the significance of 2016 is that it broke through. I mean, it broke through and grabbed hold of the single most important office in our government. But an important feature of populism is a deep distrust of so-called experts and of science and of people who hold and guard power in the DC establishment. And that distrust is not just one of, is not just an invitation to think critically about the claims of scientists or the claims of experts, or the value. It raises questions about the value of expertise itself. It's about thinking anew about how we ought to simply do away with a whole host of institutions, not so that we can rebuild them in the service of a more effective government, or one that is more deeply rooted in the latest knowledge about how to attend to a pandemic. It's about at every step saying, well, they don't really know what they're talking about, do they? And therein comes an invitation for conspiratorial thinking, for lies. I think these are all elements that reinforce one another, the anti-intellectualism that reinforce one another, that course through populism.
When you say they made it in 76, but in a way, would you consider McCarthy a bit of a start? That then it jumped to Goldwater and Reagan's speech for him, and then Reagan himself, but and certainly even, you know, the Agnew, I really think would be certainly was part of that, and then Palin was a major step.
So I guess I want to draw a distinction. It's hard to, where do you draw the line? I don't want to say that Reagan is a populist. Reagan was deeply critical of the administrative state and believed that the government was involved in all kinds of overreach and wanted to find ways to claw back the size of government. But offered all kinds of critiques of government. That's for sure true. There's a difference, though. I mean, there's a difference, not just in kind of tone. And Phil, you feel free to jump in here. Like, there's a when you shift to arguing about the illegitimacy of a set of people, or that the things are, and again, speaking in holistic ways that don't invite constructive criticism, but that are intended to simply sow anger and disaffection, right? It's not like, okay, our government's gotten too big, what do we do? What we need to do is reduce the size of it. That's not the work of a populist. That's somebody who's critical of government, but that isn't trying to, again, stir a set of emotions that are then say, well, the proper response is to walk away and to marginalize anybody who lay claims to any kind of expertise, not to engage them or ask critical questions of them, but to turn your back on them.
I will jump in here if you don't mind.
Mind
goes back to, I think it's White's The Making of the President in 64. Goldwater, is perceived as a populist right winger, and he's invited to exploit the race riots in Chicago, and he states, we can't do that. He's not looking to exploit angers and to gin them up. There probably aren't too many people who, he was like a Boy Scout in the sense that he was very careful and precise about some of the arguments that he made against government. You could disagree with them, but they were arguments and they weren't about generating and stoking heated passions. So I see the distinction that you're trying to draw there.
Yeah, and trafficking in conspiracy thinking or lying and lying and lying. It's about pointed critiques of government, which conservatives, there's a long history of conservatives doing as much. And that's not populism, at least as I've defined it.
Thank you. Eddie Fitz, you have the next question.
Thank you very much. And thank you for your time. I want to touch on the double-edged sword of like using like unitary executive power. And you know, there is this argument out there that, you know, if Trump set these precedents, or even back to like the Bush and Cheney administration of using presidential power to get stuff done, you know, he has a full plate of issues. And then we're talking about institutional reform. Is it not, it feels hard for me to like sort of put this out there, but like, is it better for him to use a more unitary executive approach to get things done and then advertise that as, you know, this is the Democratic Party, this is what we want to do, now let's go fix our institutions and democracy because look, we're solving your problems now? Or is it, we have to fix democracy first so we can get your problems, and then how populism relates to that, whereas it's like the government wants to fix democracy first before they want to solve your problems, so vote for me and I'm going to solve your problems. I don't know. I just wanted to sort of hear your thoughts on that a little bit.
Yeah, it's a great question. And I think it's an enduring feature of executive politics that long precedes Trump. So I wrote a book, it's really just a long essay a number of years ago called Thinking About the Presidency, the Primacy of Power, in which the argument is just what you've described, which is that presidents work in a system that is in important ways stacked against them. And yet they have all kinds of expectations laid before them. And in their efforts to run for office, they say, you know, look to me, I'll solve those problems for you. And so they grab hold of whatever power they can find, right? And so much of this has to do with unilateral activity. So through executive orders, national security directives, proclamations, they do all kinds of things, which are trying to, you know, push the needle and to attend to problems as they see them. And that's understandable from a political standpoint when you look at where they're situated and what kinds of expectations are put before them. It's not obviously ideal. And so I think with these latter two books that Terry and I have written, we want to say, okay, do we want to live in a world in which incremental policy change on big pressing issues about which there's widespread disagreement are simply off the table when it comes to the legislative process, and that the only domain in which material action is going to happen is when presidents exercise these unilateral powers, which are not subject to the same kinds of checks that the legislative process are. They aren't as enduring as our laws that are subject to much a lot of volatility in ways that laws are not. And they would say no. Like, so we should take a beat and say, how might we reconstitute the system so that lawmaking might be revitalized and that becomes the central domain in which problems are attended to, and not in the form of these massive omnibus bills where you just sort of stack in everything in order to overcome the filibuster. We can add that, Richard, we can add that to the list of problems with the filibuster, right? Is that it has it propagates lawmaking when it happens through budget reconciliation and the adoption of this massive omnibus bills, which are problematic for all kinds of reasons. And to say, wait, we need to rethink how we're coming together, how we're actually trying to produce policy that's intended to solve public problems, because there's just pathologies everywhere in the current system.
Thank you.
Does that work? Yeah, thanks, Eddie. It's a great question.
Mr. Lee.
Yeah, thank you. Just like in relation to everything you said, like this is just an observation of mine. Like it would seem to me that like this whole populism thing, like, you know, like with Trump, and you know, you quote it with how what's going on in Latin America and with like Europe as well. Like, won't you say it's actually just a natural evolution of democracy itself? Because like, in a pure democracy, like, you know, number is the ultimate power. Like, as long as the people supporting you, like, then you will get elected. So, like, the facts that, and like, you know, fact is, like, we, you know, from the research, we know that, like, and a lot of the research has indicated that many people are, you know, let's just say the least, they're unsatisfied with the status quo, and you know, they want to change, and also like, and the fact is, like, and also you pointed out that populism arises from, as you said earlier, an effective, you know, and I think you, if I remember, serves me correctly, you said an effective party or an ineffective government. So, and let's look at the performance of, you know, like the, you know, with Obama, like right after the financial crisis, and also like the Biden administration itself. Like I would argue that, you know, like, and like as a foreigner looking at, you know, the US right now, I would argue that, like, you know, Trump, like, you know, like, or being a, you know, like not being a traditional politician, like, I think, yes, like he did a lot of things that are, well, like questionable, I would say, but if you compare it to Biden, who is a bona fide politician, would you say Biden's actually doing a much better job? And also like the whole, you know, the far left, like, you know, the fact is, I think many people have criticized him for being too elitist, like, you know, like they're always like, you know, caring, they're always speaking of things, of caring about things that are, that realistically, that actually don't have too much effect on the, you know, on the common folk, really, like, you know, like, for some of the whole climate change and all that stuff, like, doesn't really, like, matter too much to the common folk, in my opinion, because, like, what matters to the common folk is really to put food on the table, and are they well fed, or are they living comfortably? And the fact is, like, I think from what we've seen, you know, in the last couple of elections, is that, like, you know, the fact is, what the reason why Trump got elected is because a lot of people think that like Democrats have failed that, and they're not doing a good enough job to do that. And that essentially gave Trump the opportunity to be elected. So won't you say it's actually just a natural like evolution of how things were going on? And also the fact is like I think the Democrat Party has a lot to be blamed as well for being, well, as quote, you saying, ineffective and incompetent, really. So yeah, I just want to hear your thoughts about that.
Look, it's a hugely important question. I don't think it's a natural evolution, mostly because I don't know exactly what that means. I do think, though, that it is an enduring feature of Democratic politics, an enduring vulnerability of Democratic politics, I should say. It being populism. That is, look, there are for all kinds of reasons, one or both parties can lose their way. And you've suggested a couple of ways in which that's happened more recently, both parties on the left. When they lose their way, both in terms of recognizing and speaking to core anxieties, harms and hurts felt by significant portions of an electorate, it opens up an opportunity for an entrepreneurial politician to come forward and to say, I see you, like I see it, and I'm going to do something about it. That's a regular feature of our politics, wherein for a very long time, each party is laying claim to the mantle of being, you know, the one that's most attuned to the interests of the American people. Like, that's just welcome to politics. But there are moments where one party or both parties really do, in fact, lose their way. There's this other piece, which is the ineffective government part, which is that new problems are thrown up. Institutions that are forged in previous eras by constitutional framers, in this instance, who could not imagine the kind of economy that we have or the kinds of interdependence between countries that we have, built a set of institutions that were not intended to solve the kinds of problems that we now face. And that will be true 100 years from now too, that like, even if we rolled up our sleeves, meaning got to work and got it all right, you know what I mean? That we can count on 100 years from now, we're going to have to revisit it. And so that the work of institutional reforms needs to be ongoing. And a failure to do that work, and I'd argue that we have failed to undertake that work, members of both parties over the last half century, just as, changes in the structure of economies have thrown up all kinds of new challenges, have led to this rupture, which has then opened up real harm and real anxiety, which the populists have been able to go in to and at once speak to and foment. It's both. I mean, it's not just about, well, they assume responsibility for a set of latent problems that people are feeling, and now I'm going to set to work on attending to them. It's that they also do the work of stoking the anger and disaffection. Think about, you know, all the talk about the caravan heading north in 2018 is a classic example of that, where it's about tapping, not just tapping into fear, but stoking fear, which is the work of a populist. And the answer is yes, this is an enduring vulnerability of democracies. And it's a reason why populism has taken hold, not just in this country, but in other countries in the global north and the global south, both contemporaneously and over time. So we don't get to sit pretty once we've got a robust democracy and say we've made it, that part of the work of holding on to a democracy is doing the continual work of institutional reform.
Thank you, William. We have time now for, I think, the last two questions, and then we'll give you a few moments to make some closing remarks, William. So let's go to Mr. DeLappi.
Hello. Hi, can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
All right. Professor Howell, thanks for hosting this. Just a very wonderful book and a wonderful talk. But regarding some of the proposals you mentioned, I kind of agree with one of the analysis that was said earlier with regards to the commentary. It's not so much the individuals. We're implying individuals as people are, whatchamacallit, aren't able to solve problems, that we need, that individuals can't put their minds together and solve problems. I mean, the system has worked. Our political system has worked in the 20th century and the 21st century, the system that currently is in place. It seems as if in the last few years it hasn't worked. And those are issues beyond this institution's control. That's what I'm implying here.
Briefly, I guess we'd take issue with that. I mean, we would say, I don't know exactly what it means to say that it works or what the evidence is. The amount of money that we spend on healthcare. I mean, just think about big policy changes. Yes. Are we having a constructive debate and identifying meaningful action vis-a-vis? But we haven't, a long time.
Our policymakers could. Doesn't mean they don't, but I mean, it requires them to think. It doesn't, but they choose not to do it. Does that mean we have to come in? Oh, because they're not, we elect them. We elect our representatives. And the way to solve that is by voting them out of office. I mean, if they're not solving our problems, and but I understand the role of the president. The role of the president is to set policy in the modern political era. But do you have to get rid of the filibuster to do it?
Will, can I just pick up on this and say, I think Greg's raising a really interesting question here about institutional change versus individuals, right? And and the power of election. So if you could.
All for democratic accountability and all for robust elections. And when people fail to fulfill the obligations of their position or are behaving in ways that don't align with the interests of the public, they ought to be voted out. Yes, yes, yes. There's another dimension, though, which has to do with, again, how we come together, how differences are bridged and deliberated, which can be understood apart from the individuals who occupy those offices. And we can think anew about what that legislative process is, because while there have been different parties have held office over the last 30, 40 years, the deep dysfunction when it comes to immigration policy, when it comes to tax policy, when it comes to healthcare, when it comes to climate change, is not just a function of having the wrong people in office, we argue. It's also a function of how our political systems are designed, and that we ought to think anew about how those institutions are designed if we're going to make headway.
Let's take it to Chuck's PC. I don't have your name there, so if you could unmute yourself and speak.
Hi, it's Chuck Cotolo. I'm on the Calico School Board of Advisors. Professor Howell, very much appreciate your insights, and I'm curious on this point. It seems that you're saying that populism it can be a gateway to authoritarianism. And in that context, this is my question. Some people compared the rise of authoritarianism in the 1930s to what's going on in this country now. Other people say, oh no, that's a way overstatement, overblown. Could you give me, I'm interested in your insights on where that analogy is overblown?
So I don't think that we're at the precipice of a World War III. Or at the precipice of something akin to genocide. I think, so these allusions are not altogether helpful, but I will say, I think that we are at risk of losing our democracy or compromising our democracy. And that when populism takes hold, I mean, populism can give way to demagoguery, right? Which, and I would say like, you know, Xi Jinping in China is not a populist, but he's an authoritarian, that you can have an authoritarian form of government that's deeply institutional. I think what populism, again, has to do with more the personalization of power, and it's rooted in the populist, whose legitimacy, again, is born of his outsider status, which then is why when populist rulers die or are overthrown, it leads to all kinds of tumult within the polity because it's deeply disruptive in ways that you can see greater continuity in authoritarian regimes. Like, I'm not trying to argue on behalf of authoritarian regimes, but I think there's a distinction to be had between the two. And that the threat when we recognize it as being the stuff of populism is distinct, because there you see it again taking the form of misinformation and lies, rising anger, disaffection. It's not a set of authoritarians saying, let's grab hold of the military, let's lay claim to these institutions, let's own them and put them to our own purposes. It's deeply anti-institutional. It's deeply skeptical of science and of expertise, these kinds of things. But the threat to democracy is no less real. And that's what worries us. So when the, you know, the president, again, the title of the book is President's Populism and the Crisis of Democracy. It's that the health of our democracy hangs in the balance here, and we better set to work on attending to it. And attending to it means more than just electing new people to office. Attending to it is to recognize that the design of our institutions are ill-suited to meeting modern problems. And until we set to work on redesigning them, we're going to be playing from a position of disadvantage, and the appeals of populists will continue to resonate.
Thank you. Before we invite you to make some concluding remarks, Dr. Bowes has one last question.
Yeah, I have one, and then Will, a couple of questions will come into the chat from some of your previous questioners. I'm just going to quickly mention them and ask mine and let you kind of bring it all together. One question was talking about changing the appointment process for intelligence and Department of Justice officials. Doesn't that only entrench the views of disillusioned Americans about the deep state? Isn't it the politician's responsibility to tell the truth, follow the law, and level with the public and Congress, and for Congress and independent prosecutors to address claims of unlawfulness? Another question came up about economics and the kind of the crisis of the 1930s and versus where we are today, perhaps how that raises questions about the need, pressing need for institutional reform. And then my question, since we have two classes here and this is a university audience and many of our students seek to engage in the policymaking process in some way, whether through running for office, working in government, working in interest groups. I know you're active in the public policy school and through your podcast, you're very engaged, not just in the academic world, but in the links from academia to public life. What would you say to our students, particularly the class of 2022, the graduates, as to how to work within this current system as we continue to try to break through some of the entrenched difficulties, right? The stops to policymaking that you've defined.
Those are, look, they're three great questions. Let me say a few words about yours, Mina, because it's something I think a lot about. When we think about what it means to affect meaningful change, there's a lot to be said for thinking about how do you effectively navigate politics as it's currently constituted? How do you win office? How do you ensure that your arguments are heard? How do you shape your arguments in ways that will resonate more broadly? Yes, yes, yes. But there also is a vital need for people to come forward and to think anew and think imaginatively about how to reconstitute our politics, how to reallocate power. Let me give you one example. Here in Chicago, we have a city council that is ward-based, and there are 50 elected people to the city council, and they each have their own ward, and they're spread out all over the city, right? And what we have then are 50 mini mayors, all of whom are trying to make sure that the trash is delivered well to their district and that they can, you know, get some of the city's largesse directed to their constituents. And then you say, okay, one of the big problems that we face here in Chicago is to try to figure out how do we come together as a city, to see ourselves as one city, a city that is riven with segregation and deep inequalities. And what would it mean for us to meaningfully come together? Well, when you have a city council that's designed in this way, all sorts of 50 well-meaning people who may have the interests of Chicago writ large in mind, even if we grant them that, are operating in a system that pushes back against that and says, no, 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 pay attention to your ward. Pay attention to your ward and make sure that at every step your ward is being taken care of, that the work of meaningful change, of reconstitute our civic infrastructure of Chicago, of New York, needs to pay attention to the allocation of power, needs to pay attention to whose voices are represented and how those voices not just are articulated, but translating it into meaningful action. That's the stuff of institutional reform. And I would hope that that would enter into the aspirations of students as they think about moving forward and thinking about making a difference. We don't just need to navigate politics as they're constituted, we can reconstitute politics. And that's vital work. Institutions are sticky, but they can be altered. They have been altered. The presidency of today looks very different from the presidency of 120 years ago. And when you do that work well, you can have a profound mark on the sort of the national and local well-being of citizens and non-citizens alike. So that's sort of an appeal, but that it be brought into the viewfinder. I guess the other two questions are great. We're running up against the end here, which I recognize. And I guess I want to end on just a note of thanks that you all came together and asked such terrific questions. These are the conversations I think that we need to be having more of and to find ways of having these conversations across political difference. And to think about how we meet the challenges of democracy that to, I think, many people's minds have become particularly acute of late. It's not that we had it all right pre-2016. We decidedly did not. But that the rise of populism has imbued this work with a kind of urgency that has served as a wake-up call for a lot of folk, certainly for Terry and me and for many others, I imagine, who are on this call. So thanks for bringing us together.
Thank you very much, Professor Howell, for coming to this way through Zoom to talk about your book and answer our questions. Thank you, Dr. Bose and Dr. Himmelfarben, to all the students for coming here, community members as well, for contributing and listening. Anyway, thank you very much for your time. And if you haven't read the book, you're encouraged to do so. So thanks again, and have a good
afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Will. We look forward to bringing you back soon.